You are listening to the Succubus Club on KLBC.org, your truly underground radio station.
We're bobbing along in our barrels. Some of us tip right over the edge.
It's a little long.
Not that long.
3 minute intro.
We could play it behind us.
Yeah, we'll play it behind us. Evening, everybody. Welcome to another edition of the Succubus Club. We're back after 4 weeks gone.
I know.
And what a better way to come back.
I know. We have a very special guest.
But first, that's Kitty over there.
And that's Candy. There's producer Ethan. And dun dun dun. Tim Bonnier.
Yay!
Thank you. I'm all depressed listening to Andy.
I know.
Sorry. I didn't mean to do that.
No, it's all right. Hey, listening to Andy is never a bad thing.
That's true. That's
even if
true.
It does depress me.
So we have a big show tonight, obviously. We don't have any angels to talk about since it's been on a break, too.
Are they still making that show?
Apparently.
Not for long.
That's weird.
Isn't today the last show they're taping?
They don't tape it. They shoot it on movie.
Whatever. You know what I mean.
I better do the disclaimer pretty soon, because you never know what Tim's going to say.
You may want to do that right now.
Okay, really quick, I'm going to do
the
disclaimer.
Want a delay, right? Oh, my God, Janet Jackson's breast just fell out of my shirt. Is that going to be a problem with the FCC?
Good thing there's no webcam.
It's good thing no one can see us. Disclaimer, anything we say on the show,
it's not our fault.
It's not our fault. You know, especially, we can't control Tim. We can't. He's an adult. We can't control him.
Yeah.
So anything that's said that you don't agree with, you don't like, is not condoned or approved by the radio station KLBC, the college, Long Beach City.
The state of California.
State of California, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Janet Jackson's breast, whoever.
Wait a minute. Do you guys get a lot of complaints when I'm on?
No, but sometimes we get complaints just when we're on.
Oh, okay.
People don't like us sometimes. So if you have any problems or
you know what to do.
You know what to do. Comments. Sorry. No.
No.
Comments. Sorry,
hey.
Send them to producer Ethan at thesuccubusclub.com.
That's
and he
it.
Will deal with that. Okay. See, I think I'm too loud.
No,
very, your level
okay.
is fine.
I can't even hear myself.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
You can go closer.
I'll go closer. Oh, my God. Okay.
See?
My levels are fine, then that's cool. Just because to me it sounds like I'm too loud.
Your levels might be a little weird just because you're pregnant.
Because, you know, my hormone levels are 10 times what they usually are. What?
Oh, wait, I'm having a flashback. I was going into a dream sequence there. I hope I didn't. Are we okay?
Yeah, I think we are.
All right. What was that?
Do we dare ask what you're dreaming about?
Okay, so we have a big show. We obviously have Tim here in the studio. 2 full hours with him, if he can stand it.
Woohoo!
I know. He's
and
excited.
During which we will be asking your questions, the ones that you guys have submitted. And
I thought we were going to throw all those out and just ask them.
Or take credit for them, you mean? I thought of this great question. Let me just read it here. Okay. We'll have those questions submitted by all of you, and as well a few of our own. We also have a couple of thank yous to make for some gifts that we received.
Yes.
That we love.
Yes, absolutely. Let me first thank Halfreck. Okay, Halfreck, I got your package. Thank you so much. She sent me the most...
She sent package.
I know. She sent me the most amazing baby gift. She sent me a blanket. It's like blue and green woven, like knitted blanket. No one can see me do the knitting thing. But
yeah, it's all...
She's
yeah.
pantomiming. I just want to point that out.
Thank you.
I'll do commentary.
Okay, thank you.
So play-by-play.
So she sent me this beautiful knit blanket, blue and green. And then she also sent me... there's like cat hair on my water. Okay, and then she sent me like a little sweater with a hood and with these little... it's adorable. These little buttons, and it's just so cute. And I just want to say, Halfrag, if you're listening, I hope you're listening. I loved it. I got it, obviously, and I will be sending you a thank you card. You just, it's fabulous. My husband loved it, too. It was so thoughtful, and I've gotten a few homemade gifts from people, like homemade blankets, and they're just amazing, and it just, I loved it.
As
so,
well, she sent me a housewarming gift to my new apartment, and I want to thank you so much for that as well.
Yeah. Bitch didn't send me anything.
No.
Hey, but you didn't send me anything either.
Oh, well, how do you know it's not, it could be in my trunk.
Oh, okay, it's in the trunk of his car.
It is.
Don't go to his car alone. but, yo, thank you very much for that. In addition, we got this amazing package. Go ahead and open it.
Okay.
From Australia. Diane in Australia sent us Tim Tams up the butt.
Oh, my God. We got...
And how fortunate. Tim is here to enjoy some Tams.
Yeah.
It worked out so beautifully.
And we realize it's not Arnott's. It's Arnott's.
Arnott's. You got to say
Arnott's. It's like you got to say it with the Australian Arnott's.
But
you know?
The recent Tim Tam craze that swept over the Succubus Club during our last show, another listener in Australia sent us some in a care package, and we ate them on the show, and we just about died.
And
they are that good.
See this? They don't lie.
The most irresistible chocolate biscuit.
That's no lie.
That is no lie.
All right.
So you can try some.
We'll be
open.
Right. And she also sent us the Arnott's mint slice, which I was very excited.
So we have lots of goodies tonight. And she just, we want to thank her so much for sending it. It seemed to cost a lot of money to send it this way.
We've got the toffee pops from Cadbury's.
I'm very excited to try those.
So,
okay.
We got some other stuff too. She sent us the chocolate butternut snap.
So we have all of that on today's show.
And some other little koala pops.
Depending on how the show goes, we may or may not have kitty torture if Tim wants to help. We'll see how it goes.
Yeah, can Tim help me?
I forgot what that is.
It's a Buffy trivia.
My trivia. Remember the trivia?
Oh, can you do Angel instead?
No, we don't do Angel because she sucks at Buffy enough. I don't think she
I don't think I would be able to do Angel trivia.
Well, we could try because...
Okay, we can make some
I mean,
up.
That I could know.
That means I'd have to ask the questions, and I don't have
to come
any
up
questions.
With some Angel questions.
No,
I mean I could ask you both questions.
Oh, that'd be funny.
So thank you, Diane.
Thank you very much, Diane. And so all that plus some music, correct?
Oh yeah, music. Okay, we've got Carrie Howe for like everybody. We've got Splendid, we've got Nickel, we've got Crooner, and we've got Summer Camp. So we've got some good stuff, good requests,
and we had Andy Partridge.
We did have Andy Partridge doing "I Wonder Why the Wonderfalls," and you have a little story about that, but something about the. The
demo?
The garden or something?
Yes. When I went to work on TV's Wonderfalls that just got canceled.
Just in case you don't know who Tim Einherjar is.
Yeah.
He used to do, like, Buffy and Angel.
He didn't do Buffy.
I never did Buffy.
See, I always want to say you did Buffy.
Well, everyone else does. I mean, one thing I've noticed is, like... Well, at some point, it's like, I didn't. And it's like in practically every review of Wonderfalls was like, Tim Einherjar, Buffy vet... I'm like, no, not
but
so
see,
much.
I'm convinced that you wrote a Buffy.
I know you are, but he did it.
No.
But you did.
No, I never did. Never. Buffy was in an episode that has my name on it, but it was Angel.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So let's go back to the demo.
Oh, so anyway, Andy Partridge has always been a giant figure for me.
Absolutely.
A huge hero. XTC.
Great. Who doesn't love XTC?
I mean,
I do.
Probably my favorite recording artist since I was 16.
Really?
Yeah, way before I got sober. Really. And when we were sitting around with the music people from Fox, mm-hmm. and talking about what kind of theme song we were looking for, Andy's name came up, and I was just like, stop right there.
So they brought it up.
I think Jackie Perryman at Fox mentioned Andy's name. She was just throwing out a bunch of different names, and...
And you said, stop.
That's all I needed to hear.
Yeah.
And so I thought, oh, I'm going to have to talk Brian Fuller and Todd Holland into this.
Oh.
Well, as it turned out, Brian was also a big fan. Todd, not quite as familiar. And then we got to, you know, I'm like, at least let's talk to him. We can talk to him on the phone. And we did. And he was completely charming over the phone. And I'm sure it was a little confusing. There were sort of like four people on the other end going, oh, I love you. Can you make a song? Can it be great?
Like, I don't do that.
And, well, the funny thing was is that initially we didn't want to have a theme, a title, a main title that was a song with lyrics.
You wanted an instrumental.
We wanted an instrumental, and so we asked him to do that, which was kind of weird. And he submitted like three, and it was like, okay. And then I spoke to Jackie, and I said, tell Mr. Partridge that he should just do the thing he does. And I know Andy had said that, you know, one of his instruments is, in fact, his voice. And he sent us this song, which you just played. He sent us a 39-second version of it.
And that's what ended up. That's the
title, version. And then he ended up doing a 3-minute version, which actually it's even a little bit longer. It has this great sort of Dukes of Stratosphere like intro to it that didn't get released even on the iTunes version. And then we Todd, Brian, and myself, we each put in some of our own money to finish the music video because we wanted to make sure.
I saw that.
Yeah, we wanted to make sure there was a music video, which was on the Fox Wonderfalls website, which is apparently not there anymore.
Already?
That's where I saw the video.
Yeah.
Jeebus.
But I mean, I have the video, and I can. I'll make you copies.
Okay, cool. What would they need to make room for something else?
I don't know. It's like
on the internet.
No, seriously. It's like what's that? It's like a. I don't know. They disappeared us.
That's weird.
You know what I mean?
Like from The Giver. It's they had you disappeared.
Yeah, they had us disappeared. Like in some scary movie.
Some
scary movie about South American fascists. I don't know.
Without someone disappearing.
But we're gone. Yeah.
Wow.
Go ahead.
No, that ties into a question that we had about Andy, which was, did you have to promise your firstborn to get Andy to write the theme song? But apparently he was already on board to do it, and that came from Amanda in Canada.
Well, Amanda, what we did was we actually sent Andy the pilot. The pilot was finished. We sent it to him. He looked at it. He loved it. And, you know, so we didn't really have to promise our firstborn. However...
Though you would have.
You promised mine?
What's it... No.
That's a good thing.
What's interesting is that some people at Fox weren't quite as enthusiastic about it as we were.
Mm. It's a little quirky.
It's quirky, but I think, you know...
But it works with...
It works great with the show.
Yeah, and Andy, he's awesome.
And apparently, you know, it'll never be on the radio, much like we're never going to be on TV again. And but it did work great with the show. And, you know... Really, everyone ended up falling in love with it. Like, after they'd listen to it the first time and go, bobbing along. They're, like, singing it. So
that's how it was when I first, like, the first episode, I listened to it. I'm like, that's weird.
Yeah.
And then I hunted it. I tried to find out, first of all, who signed. I recognized the voice, but I couldn't.
Oh, that voice is so.
I know, but I knew it, but I didn't know it. And so I hunted and I found it and I found the 3-minute version. Yes, I was so, and then I just listened to it nonstop. It was so good.
Well, it's like him and Bob Mould. It's like when you hear the two of them, you're just like, you instantly, you're like, I know.
And you know that most of our audience is going, who's that?
Bob Mould from Sugar.
I'm just
telling you.
Husker
Du, you know.
I was going to say, they're not saying that about Eddie Partridge, though.
No. But Bob Mould, maybe.
Well, I just have to say that it was a giant thrill for me, as you can
That's
imagine.
Great.
I mean, to be in a position to actually facilitate something like that.
Yeah.
That was a total dream come true. And whatever else comes out of this experience, this now sad experience, that will always be a bright spot for me.
Well,
and also, by the way, I saw some posts online where people, Andy fans like me, were saying, as soon as I heard they got Andy Partridge to do their theme, I knew it was doomed.
Oh.
Because he's so cool. Do you know what I mean? It's like cool.
I thought it was more of a Ted McGinley thing. Like, as soon as he goes on a show, it gets canceled.
No, it's just like any.
Jumped the shark already.
No, they were like, any producers who are smart enough to get Andy Partridge to do a thing for them, they're too good for TV.
Right, your show's too smart and it won't last.
And that's exactly why we were canceled. Because, in fact, they said, it's too good. So we can't. This is so good.
It makes the rest of our shows look that bad.
Yeah.
I mean, really.
No, really, the executives at Fox were like, I had shit to do that night, and I couldn't because...
Oh, my God.
Well, let's start at the beginning.
So we had to cancel it so they could get some work done.
So they could put up a new reality show.
Yeah.
Oh, are they going? Are they doing reality now?
I heard that. Well, they're replacing it with more of a Forever Eden.
Ew.
No, The Swan, I think.
Ew.
Yeah, and I don't want to badmouth any other shows.
I will.
Are, you know. Well, no, I mean, I just, first of all, I haven't seen it.
That's true.
And I think, you know, if
you've got to make a living.
I think it's good that they probably canceled the show about this smart, independent young woman and replaced it with a thing that tells women that they're
ugly.
So ugly that they have to get plastic surgery
and then
get put into a beauty contest and told they're still not good enough.
Right, they're still not pretty enough to be in the beauty contest.
No, I think that's good for America.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for it.
I can't wait. Let's start back at the beginning, though, when this all started, Wonder Falls, and you were at Angel. You decided... How did that go down? How did you decide to not continue with Angel and to take Wonder Falls? How did that all go down?
One word that sounds like two, Firefly.
Okay, that's your transitional...
I mean, that's what happened. I mean, I had, you know, been with Angel since the very first episode. And I left in the fourth year to go do Firefly with Joss. And Greenwalt also left at the beginning of that year. So Joss and I had more of a presence on Angel than we thought we would for the first, I would say, six or seven episodes. At least, well, Joss, certainly his presence was there the entire time. But I was actively involved in helping the Angel staff break stories for the first, like, seven episodes.
And I think I remember you telling us that, coming on the show and telling us that.
When you were here last
year.
Yeah,
when you were here.
Yes. But then, at some point, it became all about Firefly for me, because running a show takes a lot of time. And having left Angel for that period of time, by the time I came back to do the season finale, which was a great experience for me, sort of the power vacuum or whatever was left there by my leaving had been filled. And so it didn't really feel like... I mean, I'm not whining, complaining. I'm just saying that it felt like business was being taken care of and quite well. And, you know, I was certainly...
As needed as before.
I wasn't as needed, but I was certainly welcome back there. And it wouldn't have been, there wouldn't have been any kind of friction or problem with me staying there. But I just felt like things shook out the way they did for a reason. And it felt like maybe even taking a step back, to go back full-time onto Angel.
And at the same time, you're somebody who wants to be used to the fullest potential. You want to work.
I'm pretty much a lazy bastard when you get right down to it.
I guess so. But I mean,
you wanted something that you could call your own?
No. Yes, that is true. However, Wonder Falls was really not something I could call my own, because it was created by these two other guys. The pilot was already made. Mm-hmm. And what happened was, I'm just kind of a cheap date. I mean, all you have to do is tell me I'm pretty. Show me a pilot, and I'm yours. I'm yours on a platter.
A good pilot, at least.
And yeah, and what happened was, you know, they sent me I have this deal at the studio at Fox or at 20th.
Right.
And they had been sending me a lot of their pilot scripts, because they value me, and
as they should.
And they wanted me to work on some of their. They didn't want to be paying me all this money and have me just like sitting at home coming up with, you know, schemes and ideas. So they wanted me actively writing stuff and producing stuff. So they sent me a bunch of these pilots. And, you know, there were some good ones. And Wonder Falls, at the time, was called Maid of the Mist. And it stood out to me. Yeah, exactly.
It's like from the story, you know.
I got that from the first episode.
Right. Something called Maid of the Mist. That's not going to last four episodes.
No.
Only three tops.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So they sent me these scripts. And I thought it was really well written. Really well written. Really funny. Really charming. And my feeling was, I don't know how this is a series. Like, it would be really hard to figure that out. And I'm just, it's too much work. Because I'm a lazy bastard. But then I started getting calls from, like, executives at the network. Now, it was the studio, really, that was sending me these scripts. People get confused. 20th Television is the studio. Fox is the network. Yes, it's part of the same big company, but they're really two separate things. And the studio sells product to other networks, not just Fox.
And your deal is with?
20th.
Right.
So they were sending me these scripts. And then I was getting calls from the network, and I had just worked at that network doing Firefly, which was on Friday nights, which was a quirky little show. Well, maybe slightly larger than little, but it was a quirky show on Friday nights, and that didn't go well. And so I was a little leery and hesitant about going back on another quirky Fox show. But it felt different. You know, they were very enthusiastic about this pilot. And it was being shot, actually, about the time I was transitioning off of finishing Firefly and going back to Angel to break the last few stories. So then when I was directing home, they actually sent me a tape of this presentation cut down of the pilot that was about 17 minutes long. And lo and behold, Todd Holland, who directed it, shot that script. Like, I read the script and I thought, this is very ambitious. A lot of it's going to be in the tone of how it's directed and how it's performed and, you know, what's the casting like, that sort of thing. And I just thought, wow, they've really nailed this thing. This is actually better than it was on the page. That, I mean, that's how well directed and well cast and well acted this is. So that interested me. And what was really interesting was, you know, Brian Fuller had just created Dead Like Me and had a not particularly pleasant experience at Showtime. And he miraculously got yet another show picked up and that had gone to pilot, which was Wonderfalls. And he knew who I was. He had actually contacted me when I was at Angel and asked for Angel scripts because he had been on Star Trek for a long time.
Oh.
And he wanted to write a new spec to maybe look for some other kind of opportunity, and his agent said to him, yeah, Angel's great. Do you have any pilot ideas? And he's like, I have an idea about this dead girl. So he wrote that as a spec, that pilot, and then that got picked up, and then he teamed up with Todd, and then they broke this idea for this story, Wonderfalls, for the show. And so they created it together. But Brian was looking for someone to come in and run his show with him, somebody that he admired, trusted. And you have to remember, he was coming out of a situation where perhaps he wasn't appreciated and perhaps there was some friction.
At Showtime.
Mm-hmm. So, and I'm talking out of school a little bit because I don't know those people and I wasn't there.
Right.
But I do know he didn't have the greatest time there.
Okay.
And so now here he was again, you know, not as experienced as a guy who might be running a show. And he knew that he needed somebody who was at a showrunner level to come in and do this with him so that the network felt comfortable. And he asked for me.
That's great.
And in the meantime, the studio was contacting me and trying me to get to do this.
Okay.
And then the network decided, well, Tim Minear is the guy that should be doing this.
So it all just kind of...
So, yeah. So all three entities, and the thing that sort of sold me on it, one of the things that sold me on it, was that Brian was so enthusiastic to get me to work with him.
Yeah, it's always nice to be wanted.
Yes, yeah. And also he wouldn't feel like, oh, I was, you know, I was the scary guy that the network was bringing in
right.
to, like, you know, sit on him and make him do
or
it
be
the
like
way...
Scully, you know. Like,
the fact
you know.
That he wanted you...
I was a little like Scully.
You were a little like Scully?
Well, I wasn't sure. I couldn't quite believe it. But yeah.
The fact that everybody was okay with you coming on...
Yeah, like I'm saying, I'm a cheap date. So they're all like, no, you're a genius. We need you. I'm like, oh, you know, you too. And I am.
That ties into a question about your development deal.
Yes.
That you have. Cindy in Boston wanted to know, I think it's Cindy in Boston. When will you have satisfied your development deal with Fox? Is it exclusive or can you develop shows for other networks? If Fox passes on a show, can you then shop it to another network?
That's from Cindy?
Cindy in Boston, Massachusetts.
Cindy, my development deal is in fact not with Fox.
Okay. See, that's where the confusion.
It's with 20th.
Explain that.
Yes. So what I'm saying, when I was explaining before about how 20th Television is a studio that produces product that they then sell to different entities.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, NYPD Blue is a 20th Television
right.
show, and that's on ABC.
Yes.
Similarly with The Practice, Angel, of course, 20th show on the WB.
Just different numbers.
Not for long.
Mm-hmm. And wasn't Buffy a 20th show? And
Buffy
they
was a 20th
WB
show,
also?
That's right. And that was WB and then UPN. Mm-hmm. And Roswell, I believe, was a 20th show.
So your deal is with 20th.
So my deal is with the studio, not the network.
And how much more do you have to...
Well, my deal was really up this year.
Mm-hmm.
And when I agreed to go on Wonderfalls, I had been planning when I left Angel, finally. I didn't really plan on leaving Angel. I was going to maybe consult on it. The thing was, nobody knew if it was coming back.
Right.
Right, that's true.
And I also know that, you know, they call these things development deals, but what they really are overall deals that obligate you to the studio...
Mm.
Because, for instance, when they made my deal with me, they saw that I was becoming valuable on Angel. They also saw that on a season-to-season basis, my option was coming due for the next season.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time it came round for them to renegotiate that deal with me, I would be so valuable to them that they would have to pay me a lot of money.
So they pay you?
So they pay you a lot of money anyway. But what they do is they retain your services for a particular amount of time. Then, if that show goes off the air, they still own your ass. And they can put you on
so
one
it's just
of...
A, yeah, it's just a contract. With it, like,
yes, but it's called a development deal, and that's actually not
it
untrue.
It sounds cool.
No, it's not untrue. I mean, in other words, I initially tried to wriggle out of Wonderfalls after I said yes, because that's it's where I have this weird reputation for trying to quit everything I start. I don't know why, but actually what happened was I was actually in the editing room cutting home, finishing this Agent season, season finale, and they're calling me saying, okay, so you start tomorrow. I'm like, whoa. I haven't had a vacation since 1997. I mean, and that's, I mean, really, I hadn't had any time off. And I said, you know, it's, I just don't think I can physically accomplish what you want me to do. And then we actually got a couple weeks off, and so it kind of worked out. But so I was trying to wriggle out. There was a point. Oh, my point was that
I lost it too.
That I was going to go develop. I was going to, you know, try to develop something that I would create. But in the meantime, 20th and Fox needed me to help get this new show up on its feet. They really didn't feel like they had anyone else. That's what they kept telling me. Who could?
You were their last ditch effort.
Yeah. Well, I was the guy everybody wanted, and they, and as Todd Holland kept telling me, "You're our first choice. Our problem is we don't have a second choice. Like there's no one else that we really want to work with."
That puts you in a good position.
It was great. I have to say that working with Todd Holland and Brian Fuller was an extremely positive experience.
Good.
I mean, and it's like throwing a dart at a map in a way. I mean, I didn't know these guys. I hadn't worked with them before. And it just turned out we had similar sensibilities. Brian and I were virtually a writing team for the last 8 months. And, you know, it's just lucky that that worked out the way it did. But my point is...
So you re-signed?
I re-signed.
I think that's where we were going.
I extended my deal for 1 year. After I guaranteed them that I would stay on Wonderfalls for the first... And as it turns out, last season, and that at the end of that year,
well, for a guy with commitment issues, that works out great.
Yeah, and that at the end of the year, that I would then be allowed to develop in the coming year, which is coming up now. Chances are they'll want me to work on one of their other shows.
Another Friday night show.
Well, that's, you know, that's.
Let's take a break. When we come back, we'll we have more questions that kind of touch on all of this. So don't worry, we will get to everything.
We will touch Tim. Don't worry.
Touch me, baby.
And we will touch the Tim Tams too.
And I'll touch a too.
There will be a lot of touching going on.
Ow.
All right, let's take a break.
Okay.
All right. Please.
This is for so many people.
Oh, good.
When we get back, I'll tell you who they're for. But this is Carrie Howell with Anything. Okay, error. There isn't a problem with that CD. What's going on with that CD?
I don't know.
Well, apparently all those 10 people get a little bit of carry on.
I'm going to put it on this one.
Oh, we're going to try it on a different one? Okay, let's see if it works on the other CD player.
I don't know what's wrong.
No, I'm not. I'm not saying you caused the problem.
You said DJ Error.
Well, you know, because you know what? On K-Rock, like long, long, long time ago, that's what they used to say when there was a problem.
Let's try this.
Okay, let's see if this works.
It's going to be the same song over again.
Yeah,
sorry
carry
about
on.
That, but... Let's hope
maybe
it doesn't skip. And if it does, we'll be back early.
Lying down, giving in to you. I'm a hurricane.
We're enjoying Tim Tams with Tim Minear. Welcome back to the Succubus Club.
Imagine that.
These are good.
I know. I told you. On KLBC.org from Long Beach. Did I do it right, Ethan? KLBC.org, Long Beach. See, there you go. Okay. And you're listening to the Succubus Club. I just said that. I'm kidding. That's Candy. We got Ethan. And we got Tim Minear here.
Woo!
Hey, that was Carrie Howe. That after she stopped skipping. With anything.
Not my fault.
Yeah, I know. That is from Surprise 2.13. And that goes to, let me tell you. Okay. Goes to Anna. Wait, let me cross these names off as I go, because there's like a whole bunch of people.
Which means like three.
No, there's more than three.
Okay. Four.
Okay. It goes to Anna. It also goes to, okay, ALX. Alx.
Sure. Or ALX.
It could be Alex or Alx.
Or ALX.
Okay, whatever. Also goes to Mel.
Hey, Mel.
Hey, Mel. Also goes to...
So far, that's like three. Isn't that splendid?
Yes.
Thank you.
And it also goes out to... Fez.
Fez? Like from That 70s Show?
No, like Fez with a T-H.
Oh, Fez.
Unless they met Fez and they spelled their name wrong. And it also goes out to Allison.
Hey, Allison.
So, there you see, more than three.
Four.
Lots of people.
Very cool. Well, we're back. Tim's here.
Hello.
Yep, he's back.
Can I give a special shout-out
to... You can say whatever you like.
To the Buffistas.
Absolutely.
Because they're my friends.
That's so cute. Now, do you post there regularly?
Regularly. I am a Buffista.
You are a Buffista.
Yeah.
Now, what is a Buffista?
It's well, I don't really want to go into it too much because
it's
I don't...
It's like a secret society.
One of those things
it's not
kind of
a secret
about.
Society, but I don't want to, like, you know, get their board flooded. But, I mean, you know, it's... You know, it's a Buffy community. It's Buffy, Angel, Firefly, and Wonderfalls.
Just anything that's in that kind of general family.
Pretty much,
once your family,
pretty much
you're
those
family.
Things. Pretty much those things, and huge Wonderfalls supporters.
That's fair. I see.
Not a one of them has a Nielsen box, apparently.
I know. What's up with that?
I need to get me one of those.
How do I get a Nielsen box?
I don't know. If I knew, I'd tell you.
Back to questions. From the Party Man.
Party Man. He's a Buffista.
There you go. Devastated by the news, who technically owns the remaining episodes of Wonderfalls?
20th.
Okay.
The studio does. Which is why I encourage people to let the studio know, if you're interested, to agitate for a DVD release.
That was another question that I was going to ask.
Well, then I'll save all my DVD stuff for when you get there. Because I have DVD things to say.
Okay. Oh, no, that's cool. Great, actually. I was going to just kind of go into the whole, what's the situation now? Like, as of now...
As of now...
What's happening with the show? What's possible with the show?
Well, I don't want to limit what the possibilities are.
Never should.
And I know that, you know, we're looking to... other networks to see if there is, in fact, any interest to pick up the show, to air the show, to air the remaining episodes, to possibly garner an audience.
How many episodes have you shot so far?
Shot 13 episodes.
Oh, okay.
That's all that was planned, right? Because it was a mid-season replacement.
Yep. And But as I have said in many other venues, I planned for this contingency on some level. And the 13 episodes are 13 episodes that go to a place and have an ending. So this is not an open-ended arc. There's an arc that really kicks off in the episode that was supposed to air this week.
Oh, man.
In about episode 5, it plays very strongly throughout the remaining episodes, and there is a satisfying ending to that arc in the final episode. Mm-hmm. So that were this show to be released on DVD... It would be a very satisfying addition to anyone's collection.
And a full season.
And it would feel like one. It would feel like a, you know, a limited series at this point.
Right.
You know, a series that has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And I think it would not be dissatisfying on that level.
So that's your first option, is to hopefully get another network to at least...
That's, of course, the first option. The first option is to, you know... pretend it's not canceled.
I know, and we were saying, you know, I emailed you, and I was like, I can't believe that this got, that it got canceled, and when so many shows are still on, and so many things are, It just, it baffles me.
Unfortunately, I can believe it. I mean, it's gotten to that point where if a show doesn't show...
It's easy to believe because no one was watching.
Well, there's that.
I was watching, but I don't have Nielsen.
But the ratings were in the two...
The ratings were bad, and the ratings were, in fact, not even holding.
Right.
You know, I have a lot of theories as to what happened
with
the show.
Your lead-in was a reality show.
It was a bad reality show.
Yeah.
I mean, and when I say bad, I mean not good. You know, it may have been good. I didn't actually watch the show. The fact
is...
No, it was playing it straight. She had to guess who was the gay guy.
Oh, that show. That's right. They were all gay, and then they said, no, I'm not gay. And I'm like, yeah, you are.
Exactly.
What are you talking about?
She watched it. But go ahead.
Only at the end, Into Wonderful.
Right.
But, there are a lot of reasons why I think, you know, I think it was USA Today's review, one of the many glowing reviews, that said perhaps this is just the wrong show in the wrong year, in the wrong season, at the wrong time of year, on the wrong night, on the wrong network.
On the wrong night?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah,
and,
on the wrong everything.
I think there were a lot of, look, I fear for scripted television. I didn't used to. But it is true that there is this juggernaut of reality television, and it's
nice use of the word juggernaut.
And the fact is, you know, I mean, we've all been joking that it's going to put us out of business, and it might. I mean,
it's cheaper for them to produce.
It's cheaper. Here's the problem, though. The problem is that networks used to have their own identities, and they would have loyal viewers. Yeah. You know, people who were loyal to the Clap-On Network, CBS.
Yeah, the old people network.
People who were loyal to NBC. I mean, you can be loyal to more than one network, surely. But, you know, Fox had its own identity, and I think still does to an degree. Like, I can't actually imagine Wonder Falls on another network. To me,
Yeah,
I was going
to
mention that, too.
Yeah, to me, it is a Fox show.
Yeah.
The problem is Fox can't seem to launch a Fox show. Well, that seems to be a problem to me, and I think what's happened is, and this is just my own theory, but I think that people do identify networks, and they might start to identify your network as the network that develops the kind of shows you want to watch, lets you start to get attached to them for a couple weeks, and then just puts it on the chopping block. So I think a lot of people maybe aren't even tuning in because they don't want to get attached because they don't trust the network to allow a thing to actually breathe.
I think you're so right about that because I remember back when, you know, even when I was just a kid growing up, you watched one network all night long, you know, and you were very loyal to it, like you mentioned. And now there's so much switching. People switch over during commercials or they have screen and screen and they TiVo stuff or whatever. They don't.
And I frankly don't know that these reality shows I probably sound like some old fuddy-duddy when they invented the airplane. It's like, wait, God meant us to watch heterosexuals pretending to be homosexuals, they would have made musical theater. But I'm not sure that these reality shows offer a network the kind of signature pieces that make a network its own individual entity. In other words, these things they're not repeatable. Mm-hmm. They burn very bright and very hot, but they burn very quickly.
Yeah.
And I think we can all remember a couple years ago when ABC was, you know, the network of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Mm-hmm. And it, as soon as it went too far, people got sick of it, and they pulled it.
There's some fatigue left.
And, you know, the thing is, like, I mean, I don't like reality TV, but I do watch some. We watch American Idol. We talk about that all the time.
There's a few that I watch.
And I do like The Apprentice.
Oh, and I actually want to make it clear here that I'm not even remotely trashing reality television.
Right.
I think reality television is actually great television. It's exactly what television should be.
But there should be a whole network just for that.
But you know what? It shouldn't take the place of good, like, show, good fiction. It's almost like, you know, talking about nonfiction versus fiction. It shouldn't take the place of a good novel, like a good TV show is, that's written well, and you get into these characters, and you like these characters, and they're part of your life, and you enjoy sort of these stories.
But the truth is, what is a network to do? What is a network to do when they're expensive, incredibly painstakingly crafted hour dramas are not bringing in the kind of numbers and audiences that these very
money
easy
is the
to
bottom line.
Money and viewers, and I mean, and look, it is a business, and so in a sense, you can't fault them for being successful with the thing that makes them successful.
Right.
However, I do think that there is a kind of short-sightedness there, because
where is the next X-Files going to come from?
Right. I was going to mention that, because you talk about Friday 9 o'clock, and that's where that started, and it thrived there. It
was a different world.
Well, it's like Twin Peaks.
I know, that's what I'm saying.
It was like Twin Peaks.
Well, that died on its own.
No, but Twin Peaks was a Friday night show, and there was a huge following for Twin Peaks.
Right, until it started to suck.
For a moment. But, I mean, again, that was a different time.
Miami Vice was a Friday night show, too.
Well, okay.
I didn't watch Miami Vice. I did not watch Miami Vice.
No,
my friends who stayed home to watch Miami.
You know
Miami
what else is a Friday night show? Fridays. Okay? Look, they're not all good.
I know.
But, I mean, I'm just saying that that I think that if a network isn't... They can't be just Pennywise and Pound Foolish. Because if they don't have scripted television that creates a kind of loyalty that I think See My Dating Midget doesn't, then it's going to...
But
I don't know.
But it also makes...
Then I'm going to be out of work.
No. But it also makes us, you know, and I think we've talked about this before, the idea that with reality TV, you don't need to think. You don't need to follow a story.
Okay. I
don't like that.
I just think that you're being overly critical of... I think that's wrong.
No, but I think you don't... That
Survivor has as much drama, as many characters, as much life as, you know... And then I can point out a whole bunch of crappy hour
psychological drama
scripted
is
shows.
Survivor.
Do you need to pay that much attention to it? Do you need to really...
Yes, I think you do. Look, I
don't think you need to get involved.
I think it's Sturgeon's Law. You know, 99% of everything is crap. Or maybe, what is Sturgeon's Law? 95% of everything is crap, and it's slightly higher with television. And so, I mean, some reality shows are going to be great, and some are going to be not.
That's what I'm saying, is that there is a handful that I think should be on television. That I think, for example, like Survivor, you mentioned, if you watch it every week, as I have, you know, and if you pay attention, as I have, you know that there's great psychological drama in there, and if you follow it the way you can, a drama, then you can get as much enjoyment out of it as you can a scripted drama. And there's a few that are like that. What I oppose are all the little taggers on and all the little, you know, the ones that are on for 3-4 weeks that knock shows off and
I'm not here to defend reality TV, but I think that it's slightly dishonest to just say reality TV as a genre is a bad thing.
Right.
I don't believe that's true. I mean, look, a lot of people would say television is a bad thing. And they're
rock
probably...
Rock music is a bad thing.
Exactly. You know, so, I mean, I don't know that there's room for producers like me on network television anymore. It may be that guys like me and women like me, only not boys... are going to end up having to go to places like HBO.
Cable. I wanted to ask you when we come back. I want to talk about cable. And
perfect.
And I want to talk about Dead Like Me, because you mentioned it, that those guys were from that show.
All right, one of them.
One of them. I want to talk about that.
And other stuff.
And there's many more questions about. So
we're going to keep eating Tim Tams and mint slices, and God only knows what else we're going to open over
here. Don't you wish you had some of these?
Mm. I know. See, aren't you excited?
Chocolatey goodness.
You knew you came down here for a reason. All right. This is Splendid with Tomorrow We'll Wake.
On a hill.
Welcome back to the Succubus Club on KLBC.org, your truly underground radio station. It's just about 10 minutes to 7 here on the left coast, and that was Splendid Doing Tomorrow Will Wake from Forever 5.17. And that goes out to Trilim. Trilam.
Trilim?
Is that the guy from Lord of the Rings?
It could be. Was this try or two?
I'm going to stop the action now and have a speech.
That was, I hated that part of the movie. Sorry.
The tree people. Well, it's T-R-I-L-A-M, so it's either Trilim or Trilam or Treeban or I don't know. Anyway, that was for you.
Hello
Splendid.
To you.
Welcome back to the show, everyone. We're sitting here with Tim Minear, and we're hanging out. We're talking about Wonderfalls and other things. We're eating Tim Tams. And
well, we've stopped.
We've kind of stopped because
of the puking.
But not because they're not good.
No.
They're too good.
Now, we were talking before we left, before the break, about cable, about how you said it's very possible that eventually the only, the only good shows may end up coming from cable. And that certainly has been what's been happening the last few years, because...
Not the only good shows.
No. But I mean, you look at. I mean,
you know that Sopranos and Deadwood and 6 Feet Under. You know, you don't worry for the safety and health of those shows.
Exactly, and so they've kind of and they used to be what Fox used to be, which is the ones that always I could always count on Fox to do
the fringe shows, cool
yes,
and different,
the cool yeah, and different, know. The new shows, the shows I would never see on the main three networks.
Right.
I always counted on Fox for that. Now you find them. In cable. And
yep.
See, now I count on Fox for reality. I just feel like Fox equals reality.
You're right. It's sad, but it's true.
But a specific show you mentioned earlier, that which one of them came from Dead Like Me?
Brian Fuller created Dead Like Me.
He created it. When I first watched Wonderfalls, I fell in love with it. I loved it, and I loved the main character.
Oh, it's the same damn show.
Right.
Oh, please. Oh.
The character especially.
What a hack. Brian Fuller, what a hack.
Now, I love Dead Like Me. I watched it religiously.
I know Showtime, so I didn't watch it.
It's a fabulous show.
We have HBO.
I loved it.
Right.
And when I first saw Wonderfalls, especially the lead character,
Jay.
Quirky.
She's cool.
Right. She's just like George over on Dead Like Me.
She's really not, but there's a similarity.
Well, I mean, there's a similarity. Like,
the same type.
Like, they could be cousins or something.
I get that.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And that's why I was drawn to her. I really loved that kind of character.
Yeah.
And I told everybody, I'm like, if you like Dead Like Me, I think you'll enjoy Wonderfalls.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody really believed me, but no. Maybe that's why nobody was watching.
And now it's too late.
So I can't do anything. But I just kind of wanted to let you know that. That's really.
Yeah.
I didn't have a question about it, but really.
The places like Showtime and HBO have a different economic model than the commercial television stations do. You know, for instance... The second Friday that Wonderfalls was on, we were apparently the most TiVo'd show that night. But we didn't even make a blip in
right.
the Nielsens.
Right.
But people with TiVo were watching the show. But those numbers aren't taken into account. Now, when TiVo becomes, or Ultimate TV, or Replay TV, or whatever these things are, whenever these things become as common as VCRs, I think that the networks are going to have to take them into account. And one thing that they're going to have to take into account is the fact that no one's watching commercials.
Yeah.
Because they fast forward through them when they have TiVo. And so we're going to have to figure out a different way to sell products. And the product that HBO is selling with Sopranos and with... 6 Feet Under and Deadwood and shows like that is HBO. Because what they've done is they've created these compelling 13 episodes of a TV season so that people don't let their subscriptions lapse.
Yes.
And in fact, every time a new season of Sopranos comes up, the HBO subscriptions go through the roof. But you know that it's not going to get pulled after 4 episodes. You
yeah,
know?
You're guaranteed
and
the 13 episodes.
And we have HBO, so I know it's exactly true. Because every so often, like when we think, like, oh, man, we got to cut corners somewhere because we're spending too much money, like cable. Cable's always the first thing. Let's get rid of the cable because it's very expensive. But I'm like, no, we can't get rid of HBO.
Right.
I'm like, because The Sopranos and then Sex and the City, which is on.
As soon as one ends,
another one starts. We have 6 Feet Under, right. Carnival.
Yep.
I mean, all the shows that we really like that we look forward to watching.
And by the way, you know... If The Sopranos were on Fox,
it wouldn't be the same show.
Well, no, but let's assume it was the same show.
Okay.
If it had the same viewers that it has now, it wouldn't be on.
No,
because it's not enough viewers for Fox.
For HBO,
it's a huge hit.
Is a huge rating, and
right.
for Fox, that's nothing, or that's okay, yeah. maybe, but and, it's
and,
not enough.
And everyone knows what The Sopranos is.
Yeah.
Do you know
absolutely.
What I mean?
Absolutely.
So, anyway.
Well, maybe some people should...
Because I don't know that the kinds of things that I would create or the kinds of things that I do are the sorts of things that people tune in droves for the first couple of weeks.
Are you tempted to just kind of go to the cable networks and pitch stuff, or...
Well, I'm thinking about it.
Because maybe that's where you belong.
Well, go to HBO, because I don't have Showtime. And I can't afford another one.
You know, I don't know. I mean, I've certainly considered it.
Just because I think that there are some creators out there, such as yourself, writers, that think outside the box, that try and push the envelope, that try and make something different.
Yeah.
And maybe there's just not a place for it right now on network television.
And that could very well be.
Yeah. Try to make something smart and something enjoyable.
From Craig Puckett, now that Wonderfalls has sadly sailed, what are your next plans? So,
well, right now I'm adapting a Heinlein book called The Moon is a Harsh Mistress. I'm adapting that into a feature script.
Okay.
For
cool.
for David Heyman and for Mike Medavoy, who own the property jointly. David Heyman does the Harry Potter movies. Mike Medavoy's been around for a while. He used to run Orion. So these are two really smart guys. I've turned in an outline. They actually didn't have any notes. And I was
wow.
told, start writing the script. And then I got jury duty. So the moment,
been on jury duty.
Yeah. So the moment my jury duty is done, I'll be back to that. And then in terms of television, I want to develop my own show, I guess.
That'd be cool.
Not or anywhere.
Not I guess, but that's what I want to do.
Do you have any
ideas
of like what, some kind of show you want to develop?
Yeah, give away your idea.
I'm not sure yet. I mean, I have different...
Reality show? I'm just kidding.
Yeah. I have a lot of different ideas.
A show about two girls who do a radio show? No, I'm just kidding.
Hey, wait a minute. Do they fight crime? Does the day repeat? I'm confused.
Do you watch True Calling?
You know, I've never seen it.
I watched the first episode. I watched two episodes, then I stopped.
Now, we watched it, and my husband likes it because of Eliza.
Well, let me guess.
So he likes it because of Eliza, and because in the beginning, the couple first two episodes, you'd see her run.
Yep.
In slow motion?
A little bit, and just running, and you know. So my husband's like, but Eliza, running.
She's running. I give her an Emmy.
And he's just like, she's hot. And I go, I know, Eliza is so hot.
And that is the only reason it stayed on the air.
And now Priestley's on.
I believe that's not the only reason.
Well, not the
only
reason.
I think it's interesting because when you came and we were talking about this, that now we watched True Call, although I didn't watch it for a while, but then now we start watching it again, and because I don't know. Oh, you know why? Because we were gone Thursday nights. We were gone in our baby classes, so we never could watch it anyway. But so we start watching it again, and I'm thinking to myself, True Call is a pretty good show. You know, Eliza. I like Eliza.
How many classes do you have to take until you actually become a baby?
Or become a mom.
Oh, okay. A mom. Oh, okay.
They haven't given me my mom license yet. You're not fit. So apparently nothing yet. Apparently I'm still working on it. So we're watching it, and I'm like, I like True Calling. It's cool. You know, I like Eliza. She's cool. She's a good actress. It's all good.
Well.
But I'm thinking to myself, why? I mean, again, aside from the Friday night thing, why is True Calling still on?
Because it gets better ratings.
Why?
Well, that's her question.
Because more people watch it.
Why? Well, because of Eliza?
Now you sound like a kid.
I believe Eliza is not a small factor.
Right. I mean, she's not, because she has been. And that's the only thing I could think of, is because she's...
She's kind of a cult, like, she's very popular.
And she's done movies, and it's not like people don't know who
she
is.
Well, I mean, and Buffy, hello.
Well, of course.
Well, yeah.
But I just always think to myself, like, why?
What's interesting is, you know, we repeated our pilot.
Yes.
Thursday night,
yeah,
after True Calling, the very week after we premiered.
I remember.
And we got better ratings that night that we repeated on Thursday night than we did on Friday night after we'd been promoted to premiere. So one would have thought that the move to Thursday night would not be like pushing us in front of a train. However, that was not the case.
Yeah.
Because when we finally did move to Thursday night for that one ill-fated night... The Apprentice was back with a new episode, right. CSI was back with a new episode, and by the way, it said in the TV Guide that we were going to be on Friday. So,
yikes.
But, I mean, the problem, though, was that, you know, we held True Calling's numbers the first time we were on after them, and it was a fluke. And then the second time we were on after True Calling, we did not hold True's numbers. If we had held True's numbers last week, we'd still be on.
Wow.
But people turned off the show.
I just think it's... I remember reading about back in... And obviously it is a different time, and that's all a given. But that's part of what I'm saying is that I think it's so unfortunate that now they take it week to week and that they take the numbers every week and that's what they base their decisions on instead of saying, okay, here, you have this amount of time.
Yes.
And if you're good, let's go with that. Because, I mean, granted, these aren't like shows like Cheers. Like, I remember reading that it stayed on its first season. It had horrible, horrible ratings. But whoever was at NBC, maybe it was Warren Littlefield at the time, I think.
I think so.
He saw that it was a good show, and he said, I'm keeping it on the air because it's a good show. And eventually people caught on.
But I do believe that was back when there were about three networks.
That's what I'm saying. I know it's a change in time.
Drew Carey was like that, too.
I understand all of that. I'm just saying that I wish that were still
Here's the thing that we're not really scratching the surface of. While I was saying that reality TV, that I don't disdain it as a genre, what it has done, because of its fast success, and everyone's looking for the next huge thing, the next new American Idol, the next new Survivor, the next new Apprentice, is that the networks are broken up into fiefdoms more than most people really know. It's not like, we are the Fox Network, we are run by the Fox bigwigs, and these are our decisions. No. At a place like Fox, there are the reality people, there are the hour people, there are the comedy people, and all these different fiefdoms are sort of competing for the best real estate on the network.
Yeah.
And at the moment, the big jolly green giant on the block is reality television. So when you have an hour dramedy with a certain possibly Ally McBealish appeal that would normally go on a Monday night, it's not going to, because the reality people say, not in my watch. We get Monday night. That is prime television real estate. We're not giving it up to a drama. And so we end up only having Friday night left.
Monday nights. I watch Fear Factor.
See, I was watching...
There you go.
There you go.
I was watching The Apprentice rerun on CNBC.
On Monday night?
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
Because I didn't have to watch on Thursday
night.
Where
exactly what he's talking
so
about.
So I'm just saying that it's not just that reality is the only thing.
On
it's just that reality also has more power at the network.
Yeah.
And so, in other words, in my opinion, there's no reason that Fox could not have launched Wonderfalls had they have chosen to launch it. Had they have chosen to promote it in such a way, give it the kind of exposure that it needed to bring in the initial audience, then it would have been my responsibility to keep that audience. But they never brought me that audience. And so the show was doomed to failure.
So you're so the marketing of the show itself did not even...
It's okay. I don't mean to sound egotistical, but if Fox can't launch a show that is uniquely Fox, like Wonderfalls, that is, frankly, as good as Wonderfalls is, and by the way, I've seen them all and they only get better. Like, from episode 5 to 13, it's kick-butt television. It's really good. It's really, really good. Like, full of heart, emotion, humor, a great arc. It's really compelling. And the reviews, I've never seen reviews like this. I mean, we got raves everywhere, except for Variety and Hollywood Reporter. But, I mean, everywhere else. It was like from the Weekly Standard to the Chicago Tribune. You know, critics loved this show and championed this show. And almost all the reviews said, but Friday night on Fox, catch it while you can.
Right.
And I think another thing, too, that wasn't taken into consideration was, frankly, Joan of Arcadia.
Mm, yeah.
It's become bigger than I ever thought it
would. They shoot that right by outside my condo, right across the street.
I mean, I think Joan's success had a lot to do with the fact that we could... It wasn't the only thing, but the truth is, you know, we were both developed at the beginning of the year. We were conceivably going to go on air in the summer before Joan ever appeared, but they held us back until March. Mm. And by then, everybody...
You look like almost a ripoff, don't you?
Well, everyone was calling us a ripoff. I read
Entertainment Weekly. There was a whole article about the similarities of the two shows.
That was a nice article, though. Ken Tucker liked both shows.
Yeah, no, he did. And it was funny, but I just thought, well, great. Well,
we had so many great reviews and so much good press, and I would say 98% of the press, there was a Joan mention in all of them.
Yeah.
And it's...
I can understand why. I mean, obviously.
Yeah, I can understand why, too, but...
But you still want to get away from it. It's like Angel always being compared to Buffy.
Yeah, well, it's worse because we're not a spinoff of Joan.
That's true. That is true.
You know what I mean?
Okay, we got to take a break. We're running out of time. Is the crooner next? I have that set up.
No, but it can be.
Thank you.
It is now.
Yeah, it is now.
Okay. All right, this is Crooner with Parker Buffy. Welcome back to the Succubus Club on KLPC.org, your truly underground radio station. That was Crooner doing Parker Posey from Where the Wild Things Are, episode 4.18. And that goes out to Peter, who sends that out to Extofer and Nikki.
Extofer. That's well, cute.
It says Extofer.
Yeah, Christopher.
Yeah, or it could be like Crosstofer.
Yeah, Christopher.
Christopher. So I shouldn't say Extofer? I should just say Christopher? Whatever.
You could say Extofer, that's fine.
Whatever. Blame it on the
pregnancy.
Is that it? Blame it on the pregnancy.
All right. We're blaming all. Okay, just wait. When that kid's out, you got nothing to blame.
No, because then I'll still be all crazy and won't know what I'm doing.
You be careful with your Sharpie. That thing's dangerous.
Only if I throw it at you.
She did that one. She threw it at me. Hit me in the face. Called blood.
But I swear I didn't mean to.
Yeah, right.
Well, I meant to throw it.
Say. And then you blamed it on the baby.
Well, the baby made me do it.
The bad, devil baby.
Bad seed. Like that little jumper my friend got me.
Yeah.
I meant to throw it. I just didn't mean to hit you in the face.
In the face.
I meant to hit you in the body region somewhere.
Right. Okay, well, we're back.
Yes, we are back. We're hanging out with Tim Minear.
Yes.
And we're having a good old
and
time.
And he's bored of what he's talking about. He wants to talk about fun stuff.
See, we're not bored. I'm like, oh, wow.
I'm boring myself.
I'm not bored, but we're going to talk about some fun stuff.
A couple fun things.
Like, what color underwear are you wearing?
Well, hopefully it's still white.
Okay.
It was a few days ago when I put it on.
Or he's like, Atlas Solo. Let's see, let me look at the shoes.
They're Skechers.
Those are cool shoes.
Those are good shoes.
They're not red, though. They're like kind of brownish.
Yeah.
those.
Guinevere in Philadelphia asks, is Living Dead Guy your production company?
That's Brian Fuller's production company.
Oh, okay. Because she's like, if so.
Now, if you
my production company, I have a production company.
Because I was going to say, what is it called if you had one?
Because I love names of production companies.
Me too.
Mine's called Reamworks.
No, it's not.
Yeah, it is.
You're lying.
I'm not lying.
Dreamworks?
That's the name of my company.
You definitely have to go to Showtime with that.
No, but it's like reams of paper.
Uh-huh. Yeah, sure.
It is.
If you say so.
Yeah.
Reamworks.
And I also just always thought it would be funny if like Dreamworks actually hired me to write something. And Dreamworks would be paying Reamworks.
That would be funny.
That's great.
Is it real? Are you telling it's true?
Yes.
That's cool.
Swear on the Tim Tams. They are true.
Yay.
Okay, from Nick. Kind of back to Wonder Falls, but kind of not.
But fun.
How much of Wonder Falls was actually shot in Niagara Falls? Did you guys shoot anything?
We did. We shot the stuff where you see, for instance,
the waterfall.
Niagara Falls.
You never know these days how much
they can be
generated. No. We shot in Toronto.
Okay.
And the way the show was planned was that we'd shoot like three episodes, and then the last day of an episode and the first day of the next episode would fall into a 2 or 3 day location shoot down at the falls.
Awesome.
We ran out of money very early on, and so we did that like once, and then the rest. And then we sent one of our producers down with a camera. We're just like, shoot a bunch of shots of the falls because
we can't afford
to go back ever.
Please stock footage. But your own.
But it was our own. Although some of the... Well, I was going to say, you know in that one episode that you never got to see? We actually used some IMAX footage, which was kind of great.
Oh, cool.
Wow, you'd have to, like, reformat it or anything?
I don't know if they had to reformat it.
Did you have to pay to use these? Like, pay to
Oh,
use
big it time. It's really expensive.
That's why they ran out of money.
Yeah, we did an episode about... actress's name going out of my head. That's bad. That's really bad.
The girl plays Jay or someone else?
No, it was...
A guest star?
Blanche from Golden Girls.
Oh,
Rue McClanahan.
Rue McClanahan.
Everybody knows Golden Girls.
Rue McClanahan played a woman who had gone over Niagara Falls in a barrel in the 40s.
Cool.
And it was the story, it was her story.
Cool. Oh, that's nice.
And we used some footage
from the Golden Girls?
No, from IMAX.
From the Golden Girls.
Yeah, we used some stock footage from the Golden Girls. Like, why is B. Arthur in this episode?
Also from Nick, have you spent any time there at Niagara?
I was going to go up there,
mm-hmm.
and then I thought, I was literally so busy writing that I couldn't. I kept making plans to go up there. Now, luckily, Todd Holland, who was one of the creators and one of the executive producers and a brilliant director who directed a lot of the episodes, mm-hmm. was up there virtually the entire time. So one of us was up there, and that was Todd. So he was up there on the set.
Okay.
But in the meantime, Brian and I were constantly writing and breaking the next story and editing the one that was just shot. And we just...
You two did, the grunt work. I mean, you did everything.
Yeah.
Wow.
The three of us.
Yeah.
That's
amazing.
Okay.
Well, that's what happens when you run out of money. You can't pay anybody to do anything.
I want to know what happened to the talking lion that had the little thing.
Where is it?
Can I have that? Can I have that?
It's a prop. And and when it talks,
I want
CG.
The monkey.
The monkey's awesome.
I want the monkey. He's a cool monkey.
I like the you know what? You know why I have
I like monkeys.
But I love monkeys, too. I love monkeys, too. But I have this thing about that wax lion. Because when I was a kid, every time we went to the zoo or something, I'd get one of those wax animals.
Really?
Yep.
Those were my favorite things. I had tons of them. And then my mom finally made me throw them away.
Did you melt them?
Well, at least some of them probably did melt. But every time we go to the zoo, I'd always get it. We'd watch it, scoot the thing, and then
the moldorama.
And it would fall down into the thing, and be like, ooh, it's still kind of warm, and you kind of smell it.
Well, they
got your nose in front.
I know that Fox sent them out with the press kits.
Oh,
wax lions.
With the dent and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh,
smoosh face lion.
Cool. We gotta find. Look on eBay.
I just saw one go on eBay for
a lot of money.
Yeah. I mean, I have
more than I have.
Probably. I have two unopened ones at my house.
And you didn't bring them for us?
No, I didn't.
See, and we wouldn't have given them away. So there you go. I would have said no.
Nick wants to know if you were going over the falls, what sort of flotation device would you favor?
An airplane.
That's a good answer. I'm thinking like sea raft. I don't know, like an airplane.
That's really the only way I'd go over the falls.
That's a good point.
I know who are these people that go over the falls?
Crazy people.
Often dead.
Yeah,
eventually at least.
I just don't get it. I mean, you know, I understand the thrill seekers, but
And then there's the suicide people.
Yep.
Are there a lot of people that commit suicide at
yep.
Falls?
I would
yep.
think so.
The Falls have quite a history.
Well, it's kind of like, you know, like when my sister was coming down to visit me last weekend, she lives in San Jose, and they were driving to Oakland to go to the Oakland airport, and she goes, yeah, I don't know, I hope I don't miss my flight, because there's a jumper on the bridge. And I was going, again? Yeah. Jesus, they better jump after all this time. They're there since the morning.
Oh, my God.
I don't think he jumped. But, and the
well,
Vincent Thomas Bridge
not.
In Long Beach. Or it's from Pedro to Long Beach.
See, that's the thing. It's like... It's
jumpers.
That's not a jumper on the bridge. That's a procrastinator on the
exactly.
bridge.
Exactly. You're right.
Lazy guy
you know what
bridge.
I mean? The verbiage is just incorrect.
The lazy bastard.
That's right. There's a lazy bastard on the bridge.
It was him on the bridge.
That's right.
Okay?
He was just thinking about it.
He's mulling it over.
He's like, Wonderfall was canceled. Should I jump?
I didn't jump when Firefly was canceled.
This is the last question from Nick, and it's my personal favorite.
Okay.
Yes.
Wouldn't you just like to chase the Fox executives down the street screaming obscenities and whacking them over the head with socks full of dog shite right about now? Question mark?
No, not really.
No?
Yeah, it sounds like a lot of effort, actually. Plus, I'd be holding a sock full of horse shite or dog shite.
Dog shite.
Yeah.
And he is a lazy bastard, so.
You're right. Maybe you pay somebody.
What
to
I do is
that.
I'd have my assistant do it. John!
He would do it, too.
Oh, totally. I'd be like, John,
totally
go hit that executive with this sock full of dog shite.
I like your assistant.
He'd be like,
funny.
Okay.
But yeah, I could totally see him. You would tell him to do stuff, and he would totally do it.
No, as I was saying.
Sure, Tim, what do you need?
No, totally. Like I was saying to him the other day, wipe that up.
He's like a soprano.
He's like bending over. Wipe that, please.
Hey. Now, suddenly I'm feeling harassed. I'm going to have to lodge a formal complaint against myself.
Even if the succubus comes out. But wasn't he was your assistant when you were on Firefly and Angel?
Yes, yes, yes.
Because I remember talking to him before.
Yes.
Oh,
so you
God.
Just keep taking him with you.
Yeah, well, what am I going to do? Leave him back there?
That's true.
Those people would eat him alive.
He's nice. He's a nice boy.
He's a nice boy.
I mean, I call him a boy. I don't know how old is he.
Is it, he boyish? He's boy. A boyish 20s.
Okay, boy.
He's
okay.
A boy.
See, I'm a woman.
Well, clearly. And I can tell you've known the love of a man.
Yes, I have. Many times.
That's right.
At least once.
Yeah.
Yes, but see, I'm old, so I can say these things. I'm old. I could be not.
Cry. Joel wants to know...
is this Joel who does our MP3s?
It might be. I can't
Joel.
Remember.
Joel! He owes me money.
What? As a fan, what is your favorite TV show right now?
Oh, God.
As just a viewer.
No, we're not a TV show, so can't say the second
class. Oh, damn, because I was going to.
What's your favorite internet radio show that's kind of about Buffy and
Angel? That you're on.
That would be BuffyRadio.com.
And we'd be like,
then we'd shut off the mic.
Yeah.
It's weird, you know, I've been so busy making a show, I don't...
You don't watch anything?
What do I watch?
The Simpsons.
You know, I've actually TiVo'd every episode of Touching Evil, and I haven't watched one of them.
I've heard it's great.
What's Touching Evil?
Well,
it's on USA.
Yeah, I'm actually a huge fan of the English version.
Of Touching?
Yeah, and of Evil.
Of Evil. Put the two together.
But it's an English show, and I mostly when I'm watching television, I'm watching my DVDs of British television. I'm watching my Prime Suspects
like
and Cracker.
I like British television.
The Office.
Drop the Dead Donkey.
I don't know
That's
that.
Old. Do you know Drop
the you're old,
have you
right?
heard Drop the Dead Donkey?
No. My favorite TV show is Hamlet. Is that a show? Because I want it to be.
I love Hamlet.
So in other
isn't
words,
it great?
You're really
Shakespeare.
God.
In other words, you're not really watching anything.
No, I watch pretty much Judge Judy, and that's about it.
No, you
hey,
don't.
That's some drama right
okay,
there.
Okay, I don't.
I'm all like, then you're lying.
I mean, I haven't lately, because it's not like you come home from jury duty, and the first thing you want to do is watch Judge Judy.
But you want to see what you did wrong.
I didn't do anything wrong.
What could I have done?
Are you the foreman?
No, as a matter of fact, I'm the second alternate, so two people have to drop dead. Two people have to drop dead before I can actually have an opinion.
But you still have to go.
I have to go.
That's what sucks.
Do they still pay like $5 a day or something?
I think it's like 15. It's great. It's slightly better than my deal at 20th. Yeah, and also apparently I don't get to give my opinion there either.
Okay.
So that's worked out.
Oh my goodness.
Although when I told Josh that I had jury duty, he said that the Angel staff had a good laugh because they said they just assumed I'd be the foreman and then I'd go in there and say this damn jury they didn't do anything. I had to break this verdict on my own. I gave them and I came back nothing. I got them started and they were still the same thing was on the board when I left. I had to do it all myself.
Those wacky angel people.
Actually, and when we after the next break, I do want to talk about Angel, Firefly,
yes,
all that, and,
but
and
not Buffy because you weren't. Oh, yes.
God, no.
Actually, maybe we should just talk to him about Buffy. God. See what happens. You can make up your answer.
According to every major publication. Oh, by the way, my pictures and TV guide this week, if anyone's interested, and it's really ugly.
Oh God,
it's horrible.
Is it big?
No, it's like they've cut my. It looks like, you know, like one of those tabloid things. But it's about that open letter I wrote to the internet. Please watch Wonderfalls. And irony of ironies, it's on. It's in the TV guide the week that it's listed, but not going to be on.
That is horrible.
I know.
So it's a collector's item, kids. Go get one now.
Yeah, it's a collector's item if your name is Madeline Minear, my mother. I really don't think anyone else cares.
We should have bought it, had him sign it, put it on eBay. See what happens.
I blew it.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned earlier tonight. The moon is a harsh mistress.
The moon is a harsh mistress.
Isn't she?
How true is that?
Yeah.
Now, Amanda,
see
in,
her
in
she glides.
Ontario, Canada,
yes,
wants to know, when you were writing it, are you still...
I've done an outline, and I'm working on the script.
Okay. Do you have any roles pre-cast in your mind?
That's an interesting question.
Yay, we got an interesting
ooh,
question.
Cool.
It's about time.
It's funny, I kind of don't. I mean, I'm really
quick
just...
answer.
I'm just kind of seeing the characters as I did when I read the book. Mm-hmm. And as I suspect that as I get deeper into actually scripting it, because I've done a 20-page outline, but as I get deeper into scripting it and actually writing the scenes, that I'll probably start to cast it in my mind a little bit.
That's... okay.
Yep.
So it's not until you get a little more involved.
I've never read the book.
Me neither.
Is it a good book?
I think so.
Who's the author again?
He's like, no, I'm going to write a crap.
Robert Heinlein.
Robert Heinlein, okay.
Stranger in a Strange Land.
No, I know he is.
Dead science fiction writer.
I know he is. Okay. I know he is. Because I know...
Father of American science fiction.
Basically. I know who the author... I just never read... I know who Heinlein is, I just haven't read any of his stuff.
Right. And very few movies actually have been made of his...
But I do like science fiction.
I mean, Starship Troopers, he wrote that, but the movie is a...
very
good. Great, say, bad movie.
It's a blasphemous... pooing on the grave of Robert Heinlein, and then Puppet Masters, which actually not,
he
said not
pooing.
Quite so bad. Can I say pooing?
Yeah, I thought that was funny. It was cute.
Like you're 4 years old.
But the FCC won't let us say the things that we need to say.
Say shiting.
He was shiting.
See, how come you can say shite? I don't understand.
Because I said we can say.
Oh, what?
Because she's pregnant.
Oh, because excuse me, Mr. FCC.
I'm a
she's with child. You don't understand.
Because
no.
I'm a huge fan of Irvine Welsh, and he's Scottish, so I always like to say shite.
Well, we certainly said it enough.
Hey.
Yes, and we'll say it again. We'll say it some more.
Okay, another break.
Yes.
Welcome back. We're going to go have a cigarette.
Oh, I'm going to go make sure no one's smoking outside, because that's bad.
Smoking's bad.
Smoking's bad for you. Might get your show canceled.
See?
And then where will you be?
God, I thought he said cancer. And he said canceled. I couldn't believe it. Are we still on? What do you mean? Oh, cancer. Oh, thank God. I thought you... For just a minute, I thought you said cancel.
Oh my God. Okay.
Because we could do radiation or something. It'll be fine.
That'd be easier than
could
chopping
just,
it around.
Yeah, exactly. Don't. Yeah.
I know.
You just cut that out, right?
Okay.
All right. We're gonna play a song. Yes, this is for moral. M-O-R-L.
Moral?
Moral.
Not Merle?
Well, it's M-O-R-L.
I think Merle should.
Moral. And Merle. And Merle too. This is Nickel. Stupid thing. Thank you. you hemming me? Welcome
back.
We're still laughing over here. Welcome back to the Succubus Club on KLBC.org, your truly underground radio station. That was Nickel doing Stupid Thing from School Hard 2.1. What did I write?
Which is Buffy, which is the show.
What did I write? I wrote 2.13. Am I insane?
Yeah. It's because of the baby.
What is it, 2.3?
Yeah.
Jesus Christ.
Okay.
You could say that.
I know.
Passion of the Crayon. And that was for Moral. M-O-R-L.
Hi, Moral. Moral.
Yeah, you know, did I already tell a story about how I wanted to, you know...
Name your kid Moral?
No. I think of James Marshall because it's cool art. And how I have this picture of me and James that's signed by him.
Right.
And that Heather, who I love so much, we all love Heather, who got it for me when she went to one of the conventions because she got him to sign it for me. And when I was doing the birthing classes, they say you got to bring, like, a focal point.
You brought that?
No, I was going to as a joke. Like, I was going to say, oh, you know, I'll bring my picture of me and James. My husband was like, that's not funny. I said, yes, it is. It's very funny. He wouldn't let me bring it, though.
Funny in your head.
I was going to bring one of my Buffy bears, but he wouldn't let me bring that either.
What'd you end up
Well, it's my focal point.
Well, what'd you use?
Yeah.
Actually, I used a really pretty, like, rose quartz
crystal. Oh, that's
right.
Crystal. Yeah, that's
right. That's actually very nice. And it's very calming. I'm sure I'll forget everything.
As are you.
Yes, I know. I'm sure I'll forget all
calming.
Of that. That's my middle name.
Oh.
Calm and cool and serene.
Yeah.
No stress here.
All okay, right. So we're back.
Yes, we're back, and Tim and I are still hanging out with us. Can you
he
believe
it? He
didn't
leave.
I know.
And he didn't get lost in the bathroom.
Nope.
Although we told him to go all the way down, and that was the woman's bathroom, so I don't even want to know what happened.
We don't want to know.
It worked out well.
Good. Okay, good.
Good. Okay.
Have questions from various people asking about your possible involvement in now that Wonder Falls.
In the porn industry?
Practically was. Our offices were in North Hollywood.
I know, seriously.
Porn shooting across the street.
Oh, that is the porn capital.
No, it is.
But your possible involvement in Serenity, the Firefly movie. Like, what is... Do you still have any involvement, like, with
He's shaking
Joss,
his head.
With Mutant Enemy, with... I mean...
With Joss.
With Joss.
Yeah, we just... Yeah, we're friends.
He just sent him haikus. Climate
perfect.
He, yeah, Joss just sent me three beautiful haikus, which I cannot repeat. But on the demise of my latest show, he sent me three beautiful haikus.
We got to hear kind of them. Yeah, they're naughty.
No, only... They're not. They're beautiful.
Okay.
They're all beautiful in their own way.
Beautifully naughty?
Yeah. Let's just say it goes beyond shite.
Okay, there you go.
There you go.
Yeah.
People are just wondering if your involvement in...
I'm actually.
Any of that is
You know, Joss has sent me the script, a couple versions of it.
Mm-hmm.
We speak. You know, he's
converse.
He's writing and directing this, and
right.
It's his baby, as it should be.
Right.
And you know, there has been talk that would there possibly be a sequel? That I would probably be intimately involved with that on some level. So, no, I'm not working on Serenity, but, you know.
You never know.
I'm not working on Serenity.
Right, but in the future, you never know.
In terms of Firefly, I hope that my involvement is not finished with that project.
I think a lot of people would be very happy.
Yeah.
Yeah, and mostly would be happy.
That's true. Okay, Angel, switching gears a little bit.
Remember that show?
Remember that?
I do. I remember it fondly.
HDL in Aurora, Illinois wants to know. On
yeah.
Angel.
Yeah.
Who is your personal favorite character to write for, and who is the most challenging?
Wow.
Deep question.
It is.
Could they be the same person?
Perhaps.
Maybe.
Well, who's my favorite character to write for? I've been asked that question before. And my answer really is Angel, because show called Angel. And generally, if you look at my work on that show, I didn't so much write the big showy episodes for the supporting characters. I mean, I hope that I use them well. But Angel, as a focus for me, was always very interesting in Are You Now or Have You Ever Been, or in Darla, or in, you know, these stories were about him, and the deeper I could get into the mythology of that character, the happier I was about it. So that was probably the most satisfying character for me to write. The most challenging character... I can actually answer this. The most challenging.
That's good.
The most challenging character for me was, in fact, Buffy.
Okay.
In the first year, when I wrote Sanctuary, first of all, I was freaked out because I had to write Faith. Mm. Now, you have to remember...
And she is so hot.
She's so hot, and such an important character. And it was my first year at Mutant Enemy, my first year on Angel, because it was the first year of Angel. Mm-hmm. And we had just done 5x5, which to me is like the defining Faith episode of Angel anyway.
Yeah.
And just a brilliant all-around episode. Eliza is brilliant in that episode. But she has a breakdown at the end of that episode. So now I have to come in and write the episode where she's completely had this breakdown, and so suddenly she's no longer the Faith that we've known in every single episode that we've ever seen her in.
You have to write a new Faith.
So suddenly she was almost a cipher in this story. And then I get halfway, and I'm freaking out because I want to do a good job. And finally, when I get to the scenes where Buffy shows up, I just clutch. I freeze up. I don't know what to do. I'm like, okay, now I have to... First of all, I have got 3 or 4 days to write this, as I always did. And not only do I have to get the voice of this character right that is so iconic in the Buffyverse, I have to now write Buffy's voice? And that freaked me out probably more than it should have. So I went to Joss and I said, could you please write those scenes?
He's like, no, shut up.
No, he said, okay. Oh. And he did. He took a crack at him, and then... They were great, and I said, I would like it if you had your name on the script with me. I mean, it's not that Joss Whedon didn't go in and write a lot of scenes and episodes that have other people's names on them. However, I didn't want to be one of those people. I wanted, if my name's on it, I'd like it to be that I've actually written it.
Right.
And also, I just thought, I was really embarrassed that I went to Joss and said, could you write something? I don't feel up to it, and plus I'm a lazy bastard. And so I felt embarrassed, so really I was just...
But that was the right decision. I mean,
I was like basically saying, look, I'm embarrassed, you know, do you want to put your name on this? Knowing that he would never in a million years accept, son of a bitch.
He did.
He was like, okay. Actually, what he said was, hey, that's cool. No one's ever asked me that.
That's cool.
And
that is cool.
And actually, I was really excited to see my name
next to his,
and actually above his, because I called the script coordinator and said, by the way, my name goes first.
How do they do that? Do they, like, majority, who wrote the majority?
Alphabetical?
There's a bunch of different ways.
Whoever
gives them Kim Tam and
so, I mean, you know, there's a lot of people who are writing teams.
Right.
And they'll usually alternate whose name comes first. Often it'll be who is the senior producer or writer.
Okay.
Who's cooler.
And who's cooler. And then in Joss, in my case, it was who weighed more.
Who was wearing underwear at the time?
Yeah.
And who called the guy?
Who called the guy and went, my name goes first.
Because Joss didn't think of doing
but,
that.
I mean, actually, I did write most of the script.
Right.
And he came in and he did those scenes, and thank God for it.
Well, I just think that was probably the best decision. Instead of doing it and maybe not having it sound like the Buffy we all knew or the Faith that we knew.
However, I could have done it.
I could have
made the Buffy you all knew. I just didn't think I could.
Well, you're just a lazy bastard.
And I'm a lazy bastard.
I mean, you only have 3 or 4 days, you know.
Yeah, but I usually only have 3 or 4 days.
Well.
Do you wish you would have now? Like, looking back,
No, I don't regret it at all. I love the fact that there's an episode of Angel in the first year that has Buffy and Faith in it, and that my name is on there with Joss.
That's awesome.
Like, that means something.
Yeah.
No, it should, absolutely. This is more of a general question, also from HDL. Having worked on a bunch of genre programs that have been both creative and critically well-received, and I think you kind of touched on this, but if there's any more you have to say, why do you think it's so hard for those kinds of programs specifically to catch on to a broader audience? Is it just always been kind of that kind of genre that only has?
I think genre is tough. I mean, let's take the most popular genre show, and I'm accepting Star Trek for a moment,
okay,
which has many incarnations.
Right.
But let's look at The X-Files.
Right.
The reason I think The X-Files works on television and makes the jump to a broader audience is because there are really 3 things that work in our television, and that is medical shows, lawyer shows, mm-hmm, and cop shows.
Yeah.
And The X-Files is a cop show. I mean, at its
true
core, it's,
yeah,
I mean,
true,
yes, it's got the supernatural element, but the DNA of it, the structure of it, it's an hour show about 2 cops.
FBI.
And that's why it worked, because it was grounded in that kind of, you know, it came out shortly after Silence of the Lambs, and I think that it was inspired by that to some degree.
At the same time, there wasn't a whole lot of like that on the air
right
at the same time. So anybody who was even vaguely interested in the supernatural maybe flocked there.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's it welcomed a certain portion of the viewing public to watch it that may otherwise feel alienated by that sort of thing.
That's, yeah.
Not to make a pun.
Alien.
However.
Get it?
Aided. Alien. I said aided. Oh, right. Oh, alien. Sure. No, that too.
Cindy in Boston also had a comment, basically, just to let you know. Well, she says, you know we love you, right? This
Aww.
Isn't a question.
Aww. We don't, though.
I know.
just clarify.
She says, this isn't a question, just thanks for never writing down to us.
Aww.
Best wishes to you and the Beagle.
Who is that?
Cindy in Boston, Mass.
Cindy, I don't ever want to write down to you, okay?
He's doing hand gestures.
All right, then. Don't touch anything sharp.
Don't run with scissors.
I want to make sure I say...
We have plenty of time.
I know we have plenty of time, but I just could, but then I forget. I just want to say to Kristen and Allison, hi. And Kristen runs the timmyneer.net website,
awesome.
And she does a great job, and I just... I'm very lucky that she's doing that.
Cool.
What do you think of the online community?
I love them.
I mean,
I am one of them.
I know. Let's talk about that. I mean, because it's, especially in the whole Buffy Angel verse, it's become
love them.
A whole world of
yep.
its own.
Yep. I mean, I love them, and I went to them when I needed to try to spike the ratings, and the ratings plummeted. So, I mean, clearly,
they're really that useful.
Clearly they are a worthless... bunch, but I love them, and I am one of them, and, you know, I grew up here in Southern California in Whittier, and I used
Really? What high school did you go to?
I went to Whittier Christian High.
Oh, okay. Because my friend
She's like, oh.
No, my friend used to teach at Lucerna.
Oh, really?
So, you know, so
well,
you
that's,
know
that's yeah. my neighborhood.
Yep, that's your neighborhood.
And, you know, I made Super 8 films growing up there, and my friend John and I and my friend Sherry, and we would go to SF cons. When we were kids, dress up, Logan's Run, Star Trek, Doctor Who.
Awesome.
I mean, so I am one of these people who went there hoping to meet Harlan Ellison, you know, or my favorite actors,
yeah,
or
cool.
but mostly the writers, actually, like Ray Bradbury. And that's
so you really relate to them. I mean,
yeah.
I am them.
You are them.
I am and them. I am them made good. I am one of them that made good.
That's awesome.
Is that why you're so gracious coming on our show?
I think so. I don't know.
I think it's great when any of the writers, producers, any of the people who work kind of on a show that we love, whenever they get in touch with the viewers that mm-hmm. make them almost so appreciated.
Yeah, totally.
Then I love when they can talk to them, and maybe not just even in the script, but you don't talk down to people.
I think most of us, who are you? Are like that.
Yeah.
I mean, look, there are people out there who sit around and talk about the thing that we do every day.
That's amazing.
And that's really,
yeah.
that's quite an honor. I mean, it's not an honor for them, for me to deign to speak to them. What is an honor is that they take the stuff that I spend a lot of sweat and blood and time trying to create seriously. And they honor me that way. And so I... want to return the favor, if that's possible.
And I don't think enough fans of television do that. I think I think they watch a show and they throw it away. They kind of forget about it. And there's only certain shows.
But we don't hear at the Succubus Club.
Well,
no.
I think there's a certain kind
of
show.
Well, genre fans in general are a special kind of breed.
They really are.
And they're a little frightening, and sometimes they don't smell great.
Okay.
But
I totally
Yeah, I don't smell very good right now.
But no, they are the best and the most passionate and the smartest.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah. Some of them even have their own little radio shows, whatever.
Yes.
Well, we stumbled on this.
Hey, who didn't stumble?
Okay, last break, and then we'll be back with the last few questions.
Okay.
4:10.
Okay. Okay, this is such a huge, long dedication. I'll read it when we get back. But this is for...
Wait, what song is this?
Summer Camp.
I didn't put that in.
Well, maybe I should read the really long dedication.
Maybe you should.
Yeah, that was on purpose.
Yeah, this is for Christina, okay? And we're going to play Summer Camp, Play It By Ear, which is from Crush, okay? 5.14.
And David Fury.
And Christina says, great song list. Can't believe how many songs are available to request.
Yeah, not anymore. I took them all down.
Yeah, there you go. No reason for my request. I just love this song, and I can't get it anywhere, so I figured I'd hear from y'all.
Aww.
I listened to the MP3s and enjoyed them for well over a year. Want to congratulate you on 5 years. Sounds like you've come a long way.
Thank you.
As I listen to your MP3 of the 1217 show,
December.
Yes, happy birthday, Candy. That was your birthday extravaganza show.
Thank you.
I'm hearing multiple references to my hometown, state. And I figured it was time to write it. I'm in Chicago, and I always look forward to your show to perk up my days at work. So I'd like to dedicate this request to Kitty and Candy for a fabu 5 years. So this summer, can't play it by ear for Christina.
Thank you.
She's like yelling at me, and she's yelling at Tim. Oh my God!
Jesus, let's see your overall deal.
She's got like, she's like bitchy.
Somebody's got to run the show.
That was Summer Camp doing "Play It by Ear" from Crush. That goes out to Christina. The episode 5.1.
Thank you, Christina, for that lovely dedication. That was really sweet.
So
we can't believe it's been 5 years.
Really, really, really sweet and long-winded.
It wasn't like seriously.
Yeah.
Long-winded.
And you get right down to it. Could have used a little editing.
Really? Really? Want to put some notes on it?
No. I have a few notes.
Here's a red pen.
I rewrite her completely.
It says something totally different. Welcome back to the show. We're just hanging out. We're still hanging out with Tim Ainur. He's totally still hanging out with us. And we were talking about how earlier that you're one of our few people that have been on the show 3 times.
3 times.
And that's cool because people have been 3 times or more, like in our special secret spot.
You don't get anything, but.
Well, I was here for Angel, and then I came here right after Firefly got canceled.
I came here right
after Wonderfalls got canceled.
He's never going to come back on the show.
Well, good thing because we won't be here.
That's true. Maybe that's a good thing. But, you know, it's funny because we always tell people when people ask us, like, what guests we like and stuff, and I always say, well, I love Tim Ainur. He's awesome. But I said, we were so scared of you. When you first came on
what?
The show, I was terrified.
Shut up.
Oh, we tell people this all the time.
You're totally
intimidated. It's our favorite funny story.
Because it was like, we asked you to come on the show. Because you're very, like, matter of fact, you're very, you know, and you have a sense of humor. At first, we didn't know it yet. You know, and then I was like, oh my God, he hates us and he doesn't want to be here.
See, the thing is that, like,
God.
For example, when Denight was on the show, I think he was on before you. He comes on. He doesn't understand our sense of humor either. We don't get his. It was very awkward.
At first,
the first show with him was very awkward. And we didn't know you. All we knew is that you wrote great television.
Yes.
And so you're a name to us.
Yes.
You know?
Uh-huh.
So when you got that.
And we'd never met you.
Never met you. We'd never spoken to you. I think you talked to
I talked to you on the phone. I probably might have talked to you on the phone to your sister.
It was just very daunting.
That's hilarious. Joss told me the first time he met me he hated me.
Really?
He didn't hate me, but I went in to pitch some Buffy's, actually.
See, I told you worked on Buffy's.
I was doing Strange World with Howard Gordon, and that was another show that got canceled.
You have a great track record.
Yeah, no, I'm like the Timinator. I'll make sure your show gets canceled. And I went in there and I pitched, and I remember I had just come off this other show where I didn't exactly have a good time. And I think I might have been filled with rage. And I came in and I pitched these ideas, and I'm like, here's the idea, here's the plot, here's the twist, here's the theme, this is what it addresses. Like, I had it all worked out. And Josh is kind of like, just kind of had this smile frozen on his face and nodding. And then afterwards, Howard told me, he said, well, David and Josh said that you were the angriest man they've ever met, and that Josh just doesn't think he could spend any time in a room with you because you're so angry.
How funny.
But he did say that they were the best and finest pitches he'd ever heard. And then the next year I was working on, and I guess what Howard said to Josh was like, you think he's the angriest person you've ever met? Have you met yourself? And then it turned out that like Josh and I are just like two pieces in a pod. So I think we are both angry.
That's funny.
And rage.
But yeah, I was totally intimidated. I mean, now it's like, no, we're not.
Oh, please.
But at the time, I just
remember so not intimidating.
But no, but now I look back and I'm thinking that you're not. But at the time, I was like, oh, my God.
That's hilarious. I thought it went very well.
No, it did.
Right. But every break, you went out to have your cigarette, and we're like, oh, my God, is it going okay? Oh, my God.
Like, he hates us. He hates us. Oh,
that's hilarious.
He hates us. He's never coming back.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to make you feel uncomfortable.
No, because the funniest
thing. I'm kind of glad I did. I mean, it makes me feel manly. Manly and powerful.
The funniest thing was the next time we saw you was at the PVP the following February. And you're like, hey, and you were so nice. And we're like, oh, my God, who is this?
No, because we
it's all good now.
All right,
No, because we thought the show went awesome. But we were just nervous. We're like, oh, my God. Like, yeah. We didn't want to piss you off. We were scared. We're like, oh, my God.
Oh, God, that's hilarious.
Yeah. Isn't it?
He hates us. He thinks we're free.
I'm very, very easy to get along with.
No, but now we totally, like we totally feel that. You know? You're one of our, and even after that, you were always one of my favorite guests.
Well, thank you.
You know, I'm like, no, Tim, he was awesome. I was so scared of him. He was awesome.
I think the listeners really enjoy you, too.
Yes.
That's good. I love the listeners.
Aren't they great?
Oh, there's more than one?
Yes.
Oh,
there's like
the
three.
Listeners.
There's like two or three.
We have as many listeners as Waterfall.
Yeah.
Waterfall's had viewers. There we go.
So.
Not that many.
Pretty much not that many.
Yeah. About one.
Yeah.
20.
Just the one.
Maybe.
Yeah. Freya in Alaska wants to know. Said, I just have to take an opportunity to tell you how much I value your talent.
Aww.
I think that Out of Gas is one of the best TV episodes ever written for any show. Please keep up the good work somewhere. To steal from SaveAngel.com, I will follow you to any network.
That's very sweet. And I appreciate the mention of that episode. I love that episode, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Wait, what episode is that from?
Firefly.
Well, that's, oh, duh. Okay, sorry. I'm like, where's that from? I don't know. I'm freaking out.
Firefly.
DVD sets out. You should pick that up.
No, we watched it. My husband loves Firefly.
Good.
He's so bummed when it got canceled. He's like, what the? He's like,
I hope the movie does well. I do.
I do, too.
I like that pretty girl. She was pretty.
We only have a few minutes left. Is there anything you want to talk about?
No.
Is
there anything? Are there any more questions?
There are a few, but they're kind of along the same lines as we've talked about.
Oh, okay. Is there more praise, or should we just skip that?
We can love the wonderful.
I mean, I want
to... Hated to see it go.
Uh-huh, 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 uh-huh.
Oh, okay. Oh, this is interesting. This is from...
Tim is so hot. I'm going to start saying
I must have skipped that one. I'm sorry.
Yeah. That's going to be my new tagline, Stiff Faith is so hot. Tim is so hot. No, I think on a show I said, he's a good-looking guy.
Aww.
I did.
Very nice.
Jesse is in Seattle, Washington, and I'm not sure if it's a boy or girl, because Jesse.
Yes,
so either
true.
Way.
I wish that I had Jesse's girl.
But they're from BuffyCritic.com. I've never been there.
I have.
Have you?
Yes.
Do you like it?
Yes.
Okay. Well, this person is from there.
Cool.
They want to know, said, loved Waterfalls, hated to see it go, but...
Wonderful.
What did I say?
Waterfalls. Boy, it's just like, it's been off the air so long, I can't even remember what it's called.
That's a TLC song, Candy.
You're right.
I wonder what the name of your show is. Was...
She said she watched it, whatever.
I did, I
sure, did. Sure, okay.
You wrote the second episode, right? Was it the second? That was my favorite
one. That was the one that
was the
Gen Y one,
right?
Yes.
That was my favorite one.
That was cool.
That was the
third one?
It was creepy yet cool.
I love the third one. The story behind why I did the Gen Y episode was we had tested the show. We'd made several episodes, We tested the show. It did not test well among women. It tested very well among men,
really?
Which freaked out the network. They didn't know. This is our new Ally McBeal. It's too gay to sell to men. We don't know. And
that's strange.
But there were some questions that the test audience had, and I really listened. I paid attention to what they were saying. And so I crafted that episode to reintroduce everybody, which is why the blurb, just very explicitly right. with the camera going, this is the brother, here's what he is. Here's the sister, here's what she does. And to really set up who all those people were, and also to tell the audience that while Jay is a slacker who lives in a trailer, she is a loser by choice.
I love that.
Yeah.
I mean, I wish I had taped it, because
Because you're a loser by choice?
Shut up. I really identified with Jay.
Jay is awesome. And
she is cool.
I just hope that, you know, we get to air, or
will you let us know as soon as you find out? We will let everybody know.
People need to see the rest of these episodes. I kid you not.
I need to.
It's the build up to the last episode and the very last shot of Carolyn DiVerna is extraordinary. She is an amazing actor, and I'm so sorry that the audience did not get to see, or at least has not seen yet, what it is this girl is capable of. Because you think she's awfully good, but by the time you get to episode 7, she is in Sarah's league for sure.
You know what?
For sure.
Sometimes when I watch new shows and you watch certain actors kind of really hit you in a special way, and you find yourself saying, where has this person been?
Yeah, well, Carolyn has been around. She is French-Canadian. She's from Montreal. Her parents are both actors. And she's a bit of a star in Montreal in French language stuff.
Oh, okay.
English is not her first language.
Really?
Which is astonishing. No.
Oh my wow. God.
Yeah.
That's pretty impressive.
Yeah, she's kind of a genius.
I want to watch the DVDs because I'm going to need something to do while, you know, I'm home with the baby.
Yeah, don't raise it or anything.
No.
Okay.
Just set it off in the other room
sleeping.
And watch the DVDs.
Oh, that's true. Sleep!
Okay.
Hey, sleeping and eating.
That's all.
Okay, go on. Alaska.
Now, when did you finish shooting?
We finished shooting a few months ago. Yeah.
So did everybody go off and get other work, or they were just waiting to hear what would happen? Or?
Well, two of my writer-producers went off and did a pilot for Fox, which I think will probably go to series. And at the time, it was called One Big Happy.
That's
and
cute.
I hope that that goes. And hopefully it's really bad, so it'll stay on the air. But
as long as you don't touch it.
As long as I don't write any episodes, it's probably safe.
Yes.
Pretty much. I mean, we're just now finishing. We're just now finishing post. Right. We're just now finishing this. You know, the final scoring and the final effects.
I want to get back to this question.
Yes,
because I kind of left in the middle of it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Jesse from BuffyCritic.com.
Oh, hey, Jesse.
Yeah, from BuffyCritic.
That we don't know.
Loved Wonder Falls.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Hated to see it go, but my question is about my one problem with the show.
Oh, God.
It's always a clinic.
Yeah, I want to leave on a positive note.
Yeah, great.
It's the goofy background music. It's over the top and felt out of place with the show's clever, often subtle humor. Smart audiences don't need to be told when to laugh. Was this your idea, the other producers, or is this more of Fox's doing?
Well, I'm not sure what Jesse, he or she, means exactly by the quirky background music. I mean, the fact is, if maybe he's speaking about the music in the pilot, which was pretty quirky, and that was all scored with temp score initially, and then our composer came in, Michael Andrews, who is quite a brilliant musician and producer. He did the music for Freaks and Geeks. Produced the version of Mad World that is on the Donnie Darko soundtrack.
Oh,
he did the music for Donnie Darko.
Wow.
Love Donnie.
So he stuck pretty close to the template that was laid down for that pilot. If you really, I mean, it's, you know, Jesse, you've only seen 4 episodes.
That's true.
And the fact is, we use a lot of pop music, and Michael Andrews ended up doing amazing stuff in an episode with a Russian mail order bride. He brought sort of a kind of a Russian motif to the show in the episode that didn't air this week, which was Crime Dog. There's a whole very interesting sort of comic noir mixture that works very well. In the episode with Rue McClanahan, he did like 40s period stuff. I mean, the palette was it was very, very wide. And
so you can't judge on 4 episodes.
I don't think you can.
I don't remember there being quirky, strange background music.
Well, there is actually. I mean, there's a lot of this.
I mean, I'm sure there was. I just don't.
Julie Houlihan, who licensed a lot of the songs that we used, said this show was a very hungry show. Like, we had music cards at the end to try to offset some of the cost, and we had a lot of licensed music and a lot of score. Okay. I mean, it was a very hungry show.
Yeah. Wow, we're out of time.
Damn.
No. I know. I'm sorry.
I'll bet you won't be on next week, now that I've been here. It's like,
and you're right.
You know, now
we're we tuned in to Succubus Club, and it was the Swan. It was a reality show. They were doing plastic surgery on the radio. Yeah. Not since Charlie McCarthy and ventriloquists on the radio has such a thing happened.
Yes, and I know.
And it'll get better ratings.
I'm not making it to the final.
You're not making it to the
final. No, I'm not making it to the final.
Here's the situation, kids. We will not be here next week because of spring break. This school is shut down.
See, we were going to come in, but
Ethan's telling me there's a possibility, but I'm not counting on it.
No.
We'll let you know if there's any changes.
I've already made plans. So.
After that, we will be back. Oh, you have? Okay, that's right. I forgot. Never mind, we won't be here next week. After that, we will be back for at least, hopefully, 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Going into May.
May sweeps, right?
Well, then we leave.
Oh, right.
We leave right in the middle.
Because then she has the baby. You know, you always have the baby during sweeps.
Yeah. Oh, that's great.
Yes.
So.
Very smart.
Kitty is going on maternity leave after the show that we do on the 5th.
Yes.
We're hoping. I mean, there's a possibility you could even have it that week, so.
Or maybe you could have it on air. Have you thought of that?
We thought about it. The ratings would be amazing.
And plus, all you'd have to do is go, oh, keep pushing. Oh, look, here's the head. Oh.
Crowning.
No one know. It's theater of the mind. He's crowning.
That's what they say.
I know that's what they say. I'm not a complete idiot.
Partial. First
off. Small portion.
But that's the situation. As of May, we're not sure exactly what's going to happen, but don't fret, because we'll come back to do at least one more show.
Well, maybe Tim could fill in for me when I'm
gone. Not like you'll be doing
anything. Now that I'm out of work.
Now you'll be doing anything.
I might want to look to a new career.
Yeah, radio show host. There you go. But we'll be doing as much as we can. That's humanly possible.
And for those of you, I am 34 weeks. I'll be 35 weeks on basically Friday.
Congratulations.
Awesome.
I know, so it's getting there. It's scary.
So that's the situation. Keep an eye on our website for any scheduling changes, and also join our mailing list for the MP3 of tonight's show, hopefully as soon as possible.
Yes.
We want to thank Tim.
Absolutely.
You're welcome. Thank you.
For not just being here tonight, but for continuing to come back.
And supporting our show.
And for being such a great interview, so gracious, yes. And for making your trek all the way down here. We don't give you anything but Tim Tams and water. And
that's
and
all
still
I need.
Come.
That's all I need.
And the Rolos, if you like some.
That's all I need.
And, you know, just basically thank you for all the work you've done over the years that we've just loved and appreciated and
well, all enjoyed. I need is your thanks and the millions of dollars.
I know.
I wish I had that for you.
I'll write you a little thing.
But, you know, just on behalf of everybody who's listened and everybody who sent in questions, we didn't get to all of them. Hopefully we answered most of what was asked.
Yeah.
And I want to thank everybody for doing that. I want to thank Tim. I want to thank all of you. It's just
thank you.
The next 5 weeks I'm going to be kind of sappy.
I know. We're going to get all the clamps. We're going to get the clamps.
5 years you've been doing this.
I know.
Wow.
It'll be
that's certainly longer than my last two shows, Ran. When you think about it.
See, we're telling you. Yeah. Two radio chicks. Yeah. You know, maybe a supernatural radio station. It's haunted.
Yes,
you never know what could
happen.
Know.
Yeah, because radio is so visually interesting.
Isn't
on television.
It really is. WKRP, thank you very much.
Oh, well, that lasted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What about, I know this wasn't a
we could
talk
a turkey from the
news
sky.
News radio.
Frasier.
Right.
What about Good Morning Vietnam? Not a TV show, but a movie.
Yeah, radio. Right. True.
Anything's possible.
True. So. Radio Flyer. And then, of course, radio about that retarded guy.
What about Radiohead?
Radiohead. Sounds like Sarah McLachlan, but Radiohead.
Radiohead, sure.
Exactly.
I think we need to go now.
That's how the Elvis Costello song.
Radio.
Or what about Mexican Radio by Voodoo?
What about the Clash? Radio Clash.
Radio Clash.
It's a great song.
It's
wow,
true.
We veered.
What about South Central, you know, South Central Rain, which is...
I think South Central L.A.
R.E.M. song, which is about, you
which
know...
Which is called Radio Free Europe.
Yes, Radio Free Europe. So there you go.
Wow.
See? It's all about the radio.
You learn everything on the Succubus Club.
All about the radio. Yes, again, thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Tim, for
Diane.
Coming down. Thank you, Diane, for all
for
our
the
Tim
Tams
dummy
for spending
gifts.
So much money on sending it to
our nuts.
Should that white powder be in that box?
I want to thank Lori Yellowstone for sending us a Valentine, which was very sweet. Thank you very much. We got that. It's just we got it when we were
yes,
on break.
And again, I want to thank Halfrek for the wonderful, awesome baby gift.
And for my housewarming gift.
She's awesome.
You guys rock. We love
we
you.
We love you guys so much. And again, we can't even thank Tim enough for coming down again.
Oh, yes, you can.
Any last words for the listeners?
Just thanks to everyone who, you know, has been watching everything and keep watching. And thanks.
Keep an eye at timandyerk.net.
Yes, why not?
For anything
sure.
that's going to be coming up with you.
And if he gives us any information, you know, we'll make sure you know as long as we're here. So we'll let you know. And thanks, you guys. We love you so much. And Tim is so hot.
Seriously.
I'm just warm, actually.
He's kind of tepid.
I'm a little damp. I'm a little moist.
Oh, God.
And remember, kids, the vampires can't come in if you don't invite them.